The AMD Ryzen 7 9800X3D is here, and it's made some changes. Now, do these changes make it better than its predecessor, the 7800X3D? Oh, and can it actually close the gap in multi-core performance against the competition like the Intel Core Ultra 265K? And most importantly, is it a good value for the modern gamer? Well, we're gonna find out all that right here, right now on Robeytech. As if two launches this fall weren't enough, we have a third contender for your hard-earned cash. And if you're building or buying a gaming PC in 2024, you now have three choices: the new Core Ultra 265K, the Ryzen 7 7800X3D, and now the Ryzen 7 9800X3D. And like we learned in our review of the new Intel Core Ultra, cash is still king. And I do mean both kinds: the money that's in your pocket and the system resources that are aiding your CPU. So now that we have tested both the Ryzen 7 9800X3D and the 7800X3D, as well as Intel's Core Ultra 265K, we now have a more definitive answer to which processor or processors are gonna be the best value. So let's start with price. The newly released Core Ultra 265K was listed for around $400, which this was supposed to be the MSRP. For some reason, the launch price was $10 higher when we made our Core Ultra video. As for the 7800X3D, we've seen this thing fluctuate pretty much all over the map. Newegg had it listed for just under $480. We don't expect prices will stay here with the release of the 9800X3D, so it is possible with the holiday season, these might be a hot ticket item. That is, if you can find one at all, because right now they don't even sell them as mainstream Newegg right now. They're sold by third party. What about the 9800X3D? Well, at launch, the 9800X3D will have an MSRP of $479. Whether or not you'll find one at that price, well, that's anyone's guess. But what about the value? On the one hand, you have Intel. It's a new CPU that is less expensive, but you do have the new platform tax with Core Ultra. That means a new Z890 motherboard, and if you were upgrading from 13th or 14th gen and still running DDR4, that also means DDR5 RAM too. Luckily, the prices for DDR5 have come down. On the AMD side, you have a number of options. Now, granted, if you're coming from Ryzen 5000 or an older platform, the same would apply here too. You have new motherboard, new RAM. However, the options are much broader. You have X870, X870E, X670, X670E, B650, and B650E. And all of them will support the 9800X3D with the right BIOS update. When you compare the cost of a Z890 motherboard with a variety of X or B series boards, the price delta between the platforms almost vanishes. Okay, so let's dial things back a second, because we should talk about what's new with the 9800X3D before we get too far along. The first and most obvious thing that's new is that this chip is built on AMD's Zen 5 architecture. On release, we saw the Ryzen 9000 series perform significantly cooler and a bit more power conscious than their 7000 series predecessors. So with the 9800X3D, what we have is an 8-core, 16-thread CPU that has a higher base clock than both the 9700X and the 7800X3D, while matching the 120-watt TDP of the 7800X3D. But the bigger and more significant change here is where the 9800X3D stashes its cache. And no, they didn't pile on more cash, they just stuffed it into the mattresses. See, in the previous X3D processors, like the 5800X3D and the 7800X3D, AMD stacked layers of extra L3 cache on top of the CPU cores. Now, the big challenge here that these X3D processors face is actually heat. And that awesome 3D V-cache is actually a bit sensitive to heat in general, which means that power levels have to be tempered a bit to keep that heat in check. This resulted in slightly lower clock speeds on the 7800X3D and the 5800X3D than their non-X3D counterparts. It also resulted in comparatively limited multi-core performance and no overclocking. With the 9800X3D, AMD literally turned the design upside down, because now the cache, instead of being up above, is now below the core complex die. This means that there is a better overall contact between the cores and the cache. Not only that, but the cores are also in more direct contact with the IHS, or integrated heat spreader. In other words, a cooler core can go faster and be driven harder without impacting the cache. So all of that translates into a processor that has a 0.9 gigahertz faster base clock than the 9700X, while only falling 0.3 gigahertz shy of its max boost clock. Granted, it's doing that at nearly double the TDP and default socket power, so we'll have to see what that all translates to into our tests. And you know what translates very positively in our tests? Viewers like you, who subscribe and ring the notification bell here at Robeytech and also over at Robeytech Live. And now, let's look at some data. As a recap from our Core Ultra video, we ran the same tests on both platforms within the same environment, keeping core components in our test benches as close as humanly possible. We also made sure that our Intel motherboard and ASUS ROG Maximus Z890 Hero was running at Intel stock performance settings. Both the 7800X3D and the 9800X3D were running on the new X870 platform also. Okay, so let's start with Cinebench. The single core performance of the 9800X3D was not only stronger than the 7800X3D, but it overshadowed the 265K by about 28%. That is a significant lead, but it's also not terribly surprising, remembering that the 7800X3D and the 9800X3D have that stash of L3 cache. However, in multi-core performance, the 9800X3D tried to split the difference between the 7800X3D and the 265K with a 27% lead ahead of the 7800X3D, but it couldn't quite close the gap with the 265K. Now moving on to CPU Z, we get a bit more of a humbling story for the 9800X3D. While it still had a 15% lead over the 7800X3D in single thread performance and a 19% lead in multi-core, it just couldn't match the power of the 265K. Okay, so let's talk about power, because this kind of seems to be the thing that at least the chip makers seem to be excited about. We looked at the power and thermals under load in Cinebench. The 9800X3D averaged 80 degrees Celsius while drawing an average of about 147 watts. Interestingly enough, this was on average 3 degrees warmer than the 7800X3D and while drawing more power. The 265K, on the other hand, ran 7 degrees cooler at 73 degrees Celsius while drawing an average of just over 179 watts. So what does this mean when we look at performance per watt? Now, if AMD is still looking for leadership here, it's lost a lot of ground. So if we were to take our average Cinebench score and divide them by the average wattage for a rough performance per watt score, with a score of 156, the 9800X3D falls behind its predecessor at 211 points per watt. And it also dips below the 265K score of 193. Again, this is a very rudimentary metric here. It tells a story, but it doesn't tell the whole story. If we look at Puget Bench, we have some real world comparisons for creative applications like Adobe Premiere and Photoshop. Now, during our initial test, we saw the new Core Ultra 7 fall behind the 9800X3D by 8% in Adobe Premiere and by a massive 39% in Adobe Photoshop. But remember that opener about day one metrics? Well, our Puget Bench numbers changed drastically after a microcode update on the Intel side. While the 265K still came up short in Photoshop, the update helped narrow the distance between the two from 39% down to 24%. While the 9800X3D still had a significant lead over the 265K, shaving 15% off that gap is not nothing. As for Premiere Pro, the 265K went from falling 7% behind the 9800X3D to leading it by 11%. This is basically telling us two things. First, it tells us that things can change dramatically after launch, like good soup needing a little bit more time to simmer. The 265K is actually looking better after launch. However, there is still our second thing, and that is, if you've historically looked at the AMD X3D CPUs as a all play and no work, things have kind of shifted. We're seeing some impressive generational uplifts in X3D capabilities outside of gaming. In other words, the new X3D chip isn't quite the one-trick pony it was, and the lines that used to be more clear-cut aren't. However, we also have an Intel chip that's looking better than it did at first glance. And since we've talked about better, it's time to take a look at gaming. And if you were hoping for less of an AMD-led bloodbath here, you're looking in the wrong place. At 1080p, the 9800X3D showed on average a 10% gain over the 7800X3D with significant gains in Modern Warfare 3's campaign mode, Fortnite, and Baldur's Gate 3. However, in games like World of Warcraft, Starfield, and Assassin's Creed Mirage, the 7800X3D reminds us that it can, and I quote, still keep up with the youths. As for the 265K, it fell 22% on average behind the 9800X3D at 1080p. Moving on to 1440p, the 9800X3D still held a lead on average, but the margin slimmed a bit between it and the 7800X3D. Again, it held significant leads in shooters, but it actually did worse than the 7800X3D in WoW, Starfield, and Apex Legends. As for the 265K, it fell around 19% behind the 9800X3D at 1440p. And finally, at 4K, the story takes an unexpected turn. While the margin of difference between the 7800X3D and the 9800X3D slims in games like Cyberpunk 2077, Apex Legends, and Fortnite, the 9800X3D goes absolutely ham in Baldur's Gate 3 and Starfield. Unfortunately, in World of Warcraft, the 9800X3D just can't hold a Cobalt's candle to the predecessor. So on average, the 9800X3D was around 9% better than the 7800X3D, while the 265K fell behind the 9800X3D by a little under 13% in 4K. Now again, these are day one metrics. We did see some slight improvements with the 265K, but it was still the Steve Rogers in the back alley at the beginning of Captain America. It's scrappy, it's got heart, you can do this all day long, but it's still a blowout for AMD here. Now, it's not as big of a blowout for AMD when it comes to thermals. The 9800X3D averaged 50 degrees Celsius during gaming, which was 3 degrees warmer than the 265K and a whole 10 degrees cooler than the 7800X3D. When we look at wattage, the 9800X3D averaged about 4 watts more than its predecessor, putting it more in line with the Core Ultra 7 at a little under 59 watts. So what did we learn from all this? Well, for starters, we learned that if you play Call of Duty for the story, if you're an Asterion stan and love Baldur's Gate 3, or you're doing the Emperor's work in Space Marine 2, the 9800X3D, it's probably one of the best hardware upgrades you can make in overall gaming performance, even if you're on Ryzen 7000 series or 14th gen Intel Core processors. But gaming isn't the only place where we're seeing the 9800X3D flex. In applications like Photoshop and Premiere, the 9800X3D was more performant than the 7800X3D. It did take a good swing at the 265K in multi-core applications like Premiere, which is great news if you're a gamer and content creator hoping for better performance than the 7800X3D had. There is also something to be said here about how much time you're spending recording and editing videos. See, if you're editing and doing it a lot, that 11% performance difference in Premiere is quite substantial. But we have a situation where the 9800X3D is 11% better than the 7800X3D, but the 265K ended up being 11% better than the 9800X3D. When we start thinking about these gains in relation to time, we start seeing where the 265K and the 9800X3D start taking two different paths, with one having higher frame rates in games, while other saving time in production. While higher frame rates can turn the tides in competitive games, quicker renders can mean getting those play of the game moments online faster. Moving on, we also saw lower temperatures for the 9800X3D in gaming without a massive jump in wattage. That means that the 9800X3D can not only find success in SFF builds, but it also has room for that overclocking AMD says that it's now capable of. But it wasn't all gains across the board for the 9800X3D. Some titles like World of Warcraft, Assassin's Creed Mirage, and Cyberpunk 2077 either didn't care for the 9800X3D or were unfazed by it at the moment. The other reality here is that if you're using your PC for applications that are placing a heavier reliance on CPU multithreading, the Core Ultra 7 is still leading the charge there by a significant margin in some applications. Our instincts tell us that Intel isn't done squeezing performance out of the Core Ultra CPUs, and if the recent microcode changes and Windows updates has shown us anything, heck, even if the Ryzen 9000 launch has shown us anything, it's that all could change wildly in an instant or with an update. And with all that in mind, what is your recommendation? Are you still gonna just tell us what you did in the Core Ultra review and tell us to wait? So if you're on an older platform like 10th gen Intel or older Ryzen, and you're looking to upgrade and gaming is the highest priority, guys, the 9800X3D is not only killing it in gaming, but it also opens up potential upgrade paths on AM5 that, you know what, may or may not exist on LGA 1851. Now, if you're already on AM5, but you wanna boost game frame rates, the 9800X3D has the juice you're looking for. This is especially true if you have a budget-conscious build with a 7700X or below. The exception here is that if you're already using a 7800X3D, the gains in multi-core performance and improvements in some games and applications are nice, as is the lower thermal averages in gaming. However, you have to look at whether or not the gains are enough for you. Now, looking at our averages, the uplift is roughly 7 to 10% in gaming performance, 11 to 15% in creator applications, and over 20% in multi-threaded applications. None of that is insignificant, but for what you want to do with it, is that uplift worth close to $500 to you? So let's do a little thought experiment. If you have a hypothetical 7800X3D build and you were thinking about upgrading, what will give you the most value for your dollar? Is it an upgrade that would improve CPU-bound tasks, creator applications, or gaming? To ask that question in another way, do you need improvements in those first two areas without sacrificing the third? But let's say this hypothetical PC is using an RX 6000 series or RTX 30 series GPU. Would applying that $500 to a new GPU give you better overall performance for the category or categories that are most important to you? For context, that $500 could buy you an RTX 4070. Again, it's your money and you decide what's most valuable. So with all that said, if you're starting from zero and you're buying or building a PC today for gaming, streaming, video editing, the 9800X3D is the current best-in-class CPU for gaming that can get the job done for content creation as well. It's a solid pick for gaming content creators, especially for an esport pro who needs as many frames as possible for competitive play and you're creating content alongside your gameplay. That being said, if the price for the 7800X3D comes down, it's still an incredible option for the builder looking to squeeze performance out of every dollar spent in their builds. We'll have to see what the price delta is in the wake of the 9800X3D, but if it's greater than 10%, the 7800X3D is still a solid buy if gaming is your priority. But honestly, At the 9800X3D price and the difficulty of finding one in stock, we're pretty sure that AMD is leading the 7800X3D to where the red ferns grow. If you're building or buying a PC that needs strong multi-core performance for gaming and beyond, the 265K is really compelling here. While it couldn't compete with the frame rates of the 9800X3D, let's be honest, it's still a good gaming CPU in the games we tested. And in some cases, those differences weren't as stark. So you have to ask yourself, do those extra frames matter to you? Or will they make a difference in how you play your games? And even though the 265K struggled to keep up with the 9800X3D, keep in mind that gaming performance doesn't have the potential to win back time like the 265K does in applications like Premiere Pro and other creator-based applications. Again, it's not as clear-cut which processor comes out as an all-around winner. All three of these processors have strengths and weaknesses. AMD very much in gaming. Intel very much in multi-core. And for these two new additions to the CPU landscapes, both have taken significant generational leaps in thermals, and if you want to build small form factor PCs, both the 265K and the 9800X3D will work, which is a neat plus. As we wrap this up, we just want to remind you of the same thing we say every time there's a new launch like this. There is no one-size-fits-all tech solution. If you want to buy a 9800X3D and use it for productivity, you absolutely can. It doesn't suck. If you want to game on a 265K, you can do that too. It also doesn't suck. And if you want to keep rocking a 5800X3D or a 12900K system and you're still happy with it and things are great, that's absolutely awesome and totally okay. Anyway, these have been some of our thoughts and our first impressions of the AMD Ryzen 7 9800X3D. But we want to know what you think. What do you think of AMD's updates to this generation of X3D chips? Was there something exciting or interesting that stood out to you about the 9800X3D? And are you thinking about picking one up for your next PC? Something tells me a lot of people are. Let us know all that down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, why don't you go ahead and slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post videos like this right here on Robeytech. Also, if you want to continue the conversation, maybe try and figure out what might be the best solution for you, or even if your solution is totally okay, head over to our Discord server, discord.gg/Robeytech. It's an amazing place to meet other tech and PC enthusiasts that are very like-minded and love to talk about these very same things. And you know what? You might just make a friend. Also, make sure you follow us on all the other socials at Robeytech, absolutely everywhere. Guys, thank you so much for watching this video. We look forward to seeing you on the next one.